Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the skill development program. Today we are going to discuss on history taking, the presenting complaint and history of presenting complaint. Last time we have discussed the importance of active listening and ideas, concerns and expectations of the patient and the importance of summarizing. Today we will discuss presenting complaint. Some people call it as presenting illness. Sometimes it is written as chief complaint. All are same. As discussed earlier, the most important part of history taking is the presenting complaint and the history of presenting complaint. These are dynamic things, and you should try to get the story from the patient, get the narration as far as possible in patient's own words. You should define the presenting complaint, because for this complaint patient has come and you have to make a diagnosis depending upon the presenting complaint, and the treatment should also be aimed at the management of the diagnosis made from the presenting complaint. So how will you elicit this complaint or the presenting complaint? You can ask the patient, can you please tell me what is the problem for which you have come today? So most patients may say, I have got chest pain, or I have got leg pain, I got abdominal pain, I had diarrhea, something like that. That will be the presenting complaint. Before going into the details of the history of presenting complaint, you should ask them, have you got anything else? So a patient coming with the presenting complaint of chest pain of 5 days duration, once he asks that, okay, along with the chest pain I had severe breathlessness, again you ask him anything else, then he may say, I had a dizziness or an episode of presyncopal episode of a brief loss of consciousness. So before going into the details, you define what is the or what are the presenting problems. Then we go into the details of the history of presenting complaint. So once you fix it, then tell the patient, okay, you have come for chest pain, breathlessness and one episode of brief loss of consciousness. Am I right? That is how you define the presenting complaints. And once you document it, you should see that it is written in the chronological order. What is in the chronological order? Suppose a patient had chest pain 5 days, breathlessness of 2 days, you should write in this order. That is, first complaint, whichever complaint came first, that should be written first, followed by the next complaint. It is what is called chronological order. Again, remember the tendency to write all the complaints listed as presenting complaints should be avoided. Try to limit it to 2 or 3 complaints. So identify which are the important ones and you select them, and that they are the presenting illness on which you develop the history of presenting complaint. Hope this point is clear. As said earlier, active listening, tendency to ask frequent questions should be avoided. Allow the patient to talk. Allow to narrate. Many times it is seen that students and doctors frequently interrupt the patient by asking questions. So, for example, somebody has come with chest pain, you tell, please tell me the details of your chest pain. Many times it is seen that you ask 10 questions, where is the pain, what is the pain, what happened later, this sort of questioning should be avoided. Allow them to talk, at least for the first 1 to 2 minutes, don't interrupt the patient, let them stay, let them say what they want to say, okay. Once they narrate, you should facilitate them during the interview. For example, somebody says, I had chest pain yesterday midnight. You encourage them by telling, okay, you had pain, then, or okay, what happened? So you give some clues so that patient will again continue the story. And once their story, once their narration is over, that is patient perspective of the history is over, you need from your physician's angle certain things. To obtain that, you can ask leading questions. Avoid leading questions, you try to ask open-ended questions. If essential, you may ask leading questions. Is clear? So what do you mean by leading question? A question that has to be answered as yes or no are leading questions. Example, is your pain on the central part of the chest? That is a leading question. Instead, you can ask, where is the pain? Where was the pain? So patient has got the option to say whether it is on the central part or any other part of the body. So during history taking, as far as possible, avoid the leading questions. Try to ask open-ended questions. So the points to be asked are, one is onset. So in our patient, we have said that the pain occurred at midnight while sleeping. Don't write acute onset. This is something the listener or examiner has to derive on listening to your story. So your presentation should be a factual. You tell that he developed pain at night while sleeping. Or if it is on exertion, you say while doing exercise or routine activities, he developed chest pain. The P stands for the position. That is, where is the chest pain? So you can ask the patient, where was the pain? Don't ask, is it central? Is it in the epigastrium? Is it in the neck, etc.? So ask the patient, where was the pain? Next is, Q stands for quality. What do you mean by quality of pain? Many patients cannot explain the quality of pain. There are regional variations. In middle Kerala, people used to say chest pain as bursting pain. In some places, they will say it is as oppression or as if a 50 kilogram weight is kept over the chest. If patient comes out like that, it's okay. If the patient is not able to describe, we can give options. Something like MCQ, you can tell, I will say few types of pain, please select one which you think that your pain is most approximate to that one. So you can tell, is the pain pricking, burning, bursting, or any other type. So that is how you ask the quality of pain. The R stands for radiation of the pain, aggravating factors, relieving factors. So what is the radiation? This mainly for pain. Suppose you have got a pain in the central part of the chest, at the same time Almost same intensity the pain is felt in some other region. That is what is conduction of the pain or radiation of the pain. The pain is radiating, so cardiac pain usually radiates to the root of neck, inner aspect of the left arm, right arm, both arm, or to the epigastrium. So pain can, so you can ask the patient whether the pain moved to any areas. If they are not understand your question, you can give the options whether you felt the pain in any of these areas. That again comes as a open-ended question. Don't ask is the pain is on the left side, or was there pain on the root of the neck or lower jaw. Okay. S stands for the severity. How will you assess the severity of the pain? One, by asking the patient to say mild pain, moderate pain, severe pain. Second is, ask the patient what did they do with the pain. Somebody says, because of chest pain, I didn't go for any work, I was taking rest. That means the pain was significant. Or you can use a visual analog scale. So what is in the visual analog scale? Tell the patient, if the maximum pain is 10 and no pain is 0, where does your pain comes? Somebody may at the level of 5, 6, 7, something like that, and you can quantify the pain. Next is, T stands for time. Yeah, I already told you, the history should be taken in such a way that you are working with the patient on a timeline. So pain occurred on 5 days back. You should describe what happened to the pain, whether the pain recurred, whether the pain is persistent, or whether there was no pain at all later. So, the temporal progression of a symptom should be stressed. It is because by identifying the pattern or the during the time what happened, often you go to etiological diagnosis. So we will study this at a later time, but at least you should remember that the temporal progression of the disease should be asked for. And last is A. A stands for associations. Many of the major symptoms have got some associations. For example, headache is often associated with vomiting or visual disturbance. Chest pain is usually associated with palpitation, breathlessness, or fatigability. So remember to ask about the likely associations. This depends upon listening to the story, you will understand the system is affected. You try to interrogate the major symptoms of that system, or what is called asking about the pertinent negatives of the particular symptom. As you advance in your study, you will understand what are the questions to be asked for. Another way of remembering is using the same Socrates, almost same. I prefer the O, P, Q, R, S, T, and A. Whatever be the symptom, the relevant part of this can be used. This is mainly for analyzing pain, but let be any other symptom. You can modify this and use it for analyzing the history presenting illness. So there is a tendency for many of the students to write presenting complaint chest pain 5 days. Try to avoid this sort of briefing. Try to make the presenting complaint in a full sentence or as a phrase which is standalone. That is, by listening to that, you will be able to understand, okay, whether the patient is having some particular problem. For example, the chest pain can be described as central chest pain lasting for around 30 minutes while at rest 5 days back. This gives an inference And again, another important thing is that once you finish your studies, most of you are not going to write a detailed story except in an academic institution or working with some insurance companies, etc. So most often the OP ticket, what you are writing is the presenting complaint. So write it like this, so that this will be beneficial to you, and another person reading this, they will understand what is the problem. And second point to be remembered is that in the history of presenting illness or presenting complaint, narrate everything on this scale. Whether it is present or absent, you should tell it as, if it is absent, you say absent. If there is no radiation, you tell there is no radiation of the pain. So don't just write chest pain, 5 minutes, etc. So the whole story of the patient, preferably in patient's own words, you should write down. Not like a computer language, onset is acute, site is central, quality is sharp pain. So try to make a story. You tell 5 days back, at night, while sleeping, he developed central chest pain. The pain lasted for half an hour. It was bursting in type and had radiation to the inner aspect of the left arm. He sweated profusely and had breathlessness, and he felt dizzy. And for this complaint, he was taken to the hospital. In the hospital, he was given some injections and the pain got relieved. The following days, he did not have any recurrence of the chest pain. So we have said most of the things. So once you get experience, without thinking about the OPQR STA, automatically the necessary questions and necessary description will come. So rest of the things are very easy. We go into the past medical history. This will include the surgical story. And if patient is a female, get the obstetric history also. The major points to be, these are all standardized questions. So here you can ask leading questions. So minimum things to be asked, remember by MJ threats. M stands for cardiac pain or myocardial infarction history. J stands for jaundice. T stands for tuberculosis. S stands for hypertension. R for history of rheumatic fever or rheumatic heart disease. E stands for epilepsy or seizures. A stands for bronchial asthma or obstructive airway disease. D stands for diabetes mellitus. S stands for stroke. And C stands for cancer. So remember this mnemonic. And if there are no significant thing in the past, you elicit this thing and tell patient is having any of these present or absent. There is no need to write an elaborate story in the past medical history. We can be brief, tell in phrases. For example, you can say in 1986, he had an appendectomy. In 90, he has chest pain, evaluated, undergone angioplasty. Something like that. So brief and to the point. Next is drug history. Along with the past medical history, for example, somebody is diabetic. You can say diabetes mellitus type 2 on metformin. If you know the dose, you write down the dose also twice daily. There is no meaning in writing that he is a diabetic. We should include the medications. and whether the if there is the available, you write down whether the diabetes status was controlled. Same thing for hypertension. So include all medicines, especially write down a subheading allergy history. Whether the patient is allergic to any drugs or any food or anything else. This should be written carefully, because if a patient is non-diabetic and then you prescribe that medicine, you are liable for negligence. So if for your own safety, allergy history should be recorded. Include the over-the-counter medications. Think about recreational drugs and drug abuse also. Then comes the family history. Here we are describing about a patient with chest pain. So history of premature coronary artery disease is very important. So ask whether your father or mother had coronary disease, the age at which the coronary disease has happened. Father less than 55 and females more than 60 is considered significant. Somebody dies at the age of 70 with coronary disease is not a risk factor for cardiac disease. Many diseases have got genetic basis. So it's always a good habit to draw the family tree. So you should know the symbols for drawing the family tree. So this is females are represented and males are represented like this, marriage like this, consanguineous like this, divorce is like this, and other symbols are here, miscarriage, male, pregnant, identical twins, non-identical twins. So as a student, it is always a good practice to draw the family tree. It is especially important for diseases which can run in families. So how can you understand? Only by drawing the family tree. Three generations, if this is the patient, patient's parents, about the siblings and offsprings. That is how you take the history. That is parent, patient and siblings and the offsprings. Some diseases are inherited autosomal dominant, that is single gene disorders. Some are recessive. By knowing the or drawing the family tree, we can identify which one is autosomal dominant, which means autosomal recessive. So this picture is an autosomal dominant disease. This is the affected person. You can see that 1 in 2, there is 4 offsprings. 50% is unaffected, 50% is affected. Both male and female will be affected. So this sort of inheritance is consistent with autosomal dominant. This is autosomal recessive. Both parents contain the having the defective gene. There is 1 in 4 chance, if there are 4 offsprings, there is 1 in 4, 25% of the children will get disease, and there can be skipped in some generations, the disease may not be there also. So details of this you will study when you read study genetics. At least this is to impress you upon the importance of drawing the family tree. There are some conditions which can be excellent. Typical example is hemophilia. You can see that only boys are affected, females are carriers and they are not affected. So there is 50% chance for the boys to develop the disease. Some of the diseases are multifactorial, but there may be clustering in family. So again, you can understand this by drawing the family tree. So certain disorders may occur in family. It may be multifactorial. There may be genetic basis also. Now comes to social history, the social and occupational history. Many students confine to bowel and bladder. It is said that Indians defecate in public and eat in private. So actually by social history, we are interested in the home and home surroundings. What is the support system? Second is high risk behaviors. Third is travel history. Fourth is the occupational history. You should include the present occupation and the past occupation. Alcohol and tobacco use are two important high risk behaviors. There is some classification for understanding the or categorizing the patient's income. We will not be discussing this in detail now. Just remember the framework under which you should write down. Social history should be expanded depending upon the situation. For example, somebody has got a respiratory disease, exposure to pets, dust, asbestos, birds, etc. are important. Travel history, risk factors for HIV, that is multiple sexual exposures, multiple partners, that should be asked for. And you should be careful in eliciting the sexual history. Only once you get a rapport, then you go for elicitation of the sexual history. Regarding smoking, rather than telling he is a smoker, try to calculate the pack years. Suppose someone smokes one pack of cigarettes per day for 3 years. Usually 20 cigarettes are in a packet. So the calculation of pack years is number of cigarettes per day divided by 20 into number of years. So here 20 cigarettes divided by 20, that is one pack, into 3 years is equal to 3 pack years. Okay. Regarding alcohol, try to quantify the alcohol. One standard peg is 30 ml. Many of us think that it is 60 ml, it is only 30 ml, which contains 10 ml of alcohol equal to around 8 grams. In many Western countries, the recommended maximum limit of safe use of alcohol is 14 units. That is 2 pegs a day is the maximum permissible. This is equal to 4 pints of beer or 5 glasses of wine. One glass of wine is 175 ml, is approximately 14% alcohol, and one pint of beer is 568 ml, it is approximately 5.2% strength in alcohol. Now we come to the last part, the review of systems. Many students confuse it for examination. Review system is symptom analysis. It is only symptoms. Don't repeat the symptoms Oh, about which you have discussed in the presenting complaint, history of presenting complaint. The idea is to see that you have not missed anything important. So how to take? Look at the patient as a whole and think about complaints. Ask about any headache, any visual problem, any swallowing problem, then coming to the neck, any thyroid problem or symptoms related to thyroids, coming to the chest, you know, cough, breathlessness, CVS, all of you know, then coming to the abdomen, abdominal pain, jaundice, going to the musculoskeletal, you ask whether joint pains. So look at the patient as a whole and review the whole of systems. It is not limited to the basic systems of cardiovascular, respiratory, neurology and gastrointestinal. Think about all systems. So imagine the patient and review the symptoms related to, major symptoms related to each part. And the review of systems is usually a negative story. If there are some positive symptoms, you can add it at the end of the history of presenting illness. You can say, in addition, the patient is having a headache for the last so many days, something like that. If it is a long lasting problems, you add it along with the past medical history. Okay. Again, I repeat, this is symptom analysis, not examination findings. Now, think about ideas, concerns, and expectations. You summarize the problem. Okay, Mr. So-and-so, I have taken your history. What I understood is you are having chest pain, which is central, with a radiation to the left arm, the severe pain associated with the sweating and breathlessness, and you are very uncomfortable at that time. Later you developed breathlessness and felt dizziness. You have been admitted here, you have taken some injection and your pain has subsided, and you had past history of diabetes and hypertension, and you are on regular medication. Okay, is it correct? At each level you can clarify and make appropriate corrections. Then you can ask him, what do you think, or any particular concerns are there? Some of the patient may say, their concerns, they will say, you try to elicit that, and you tell the patient, I feel that you are having a cardiac pain, you need an angiogram after the physical examination, or you may need some investigations to confirm this. Let me examine and then decide on that, or I will discuss with your consultant. So that is how you summarize the problem. And the last step, the 10th step, you ask the patient, have you got anything, any doubts to ask? Give an opportunity for the patient to tell anything, any other problems or any other questions he has got. So by this we have finished the history taking. We are discussing two parts. One is the introductory aspect, followed by presenting complaint and the history of presenting complaint, the most important parts of the history taking, which is dynamic, and you should allow the patient to narrate the story without much interruptions. If at all, you ask some open-ended questions. Rest of the things, they are routine things, you can just ask and write it down. So if you have got 15 minutes, 10 minutes for the presenting complaint and history of the presenting complaint. Rest of the things you can quickly go through. So by this, we will finish the history taking. And next session, we will try to discuss how this is done with a patient, how the history is being taken. Hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you.